Hi, I'm Stephen Feuerstein, and I write practically perfect PLSQL. Hello, everybody. Welcome back to my ongoing series of coding therapy for software professionals. Hopefully, you've checked out some of my other videos. Now it's time to talk about shock therapy for software developers. Now, as I said in my overview to this series, I want to make sure that nobody takes offense and misunderstands that I would make light of electroshock therapy. Really tough, hard stuff. That's not what this is about. What I want to talk about in terms of shock therapy in the context of software is essentially breaking bad habits. So humans, maybe everything out there, are creatures of habit. We develop approaches to doing things and we just want to keep on doing them. Change is hard. Now, lots of our habits are really good. No reason to stop doing them. Some of our habits may be not so optimal. Still hard to break out of. And I think in particular, you know, it's funny what we learn and experience in our adolescence when the hormones are really revving up, when our neurons and our neural networks are sort of locking down and starting to, calcify as we get older and older. The things we learn in our adolescence really stick with us. For example, I have this deep emotional attachment to the music that I listened to when I was a teenager, and I think a lot of people do. So the reason I say this is to offer an example of some of my bad habits, my need for some shock therapy myself. In my PLSQL adolescence, when I was relatively new to PLSQL, when PLSQL was itself relatively new, essentially version 7 of Oracle, I kind of burned in my knowledge of PLSQL. And then I started using it a lot, writing about it and so on. And of course, Oracle went from 7 to 8 to 8i, 9 and so forth. And it wasn't until Oracle 9 that I realized that while I was writing about new features and certainly was aware of them, my main habits of coding were still sort of based on an Oracle 7 reference point. I hadn't really broken away from thinking in terms of Oracle 7 PLSQL as I was writing my code. And I'm sure you have similar experiences. So the bottom line is that we should work to break out of the bad habits we have. We have to be able to recognize them first, of course. And sometimes you need to be given a shock, a real hard shake to say, Stephen, the things you've always thought were fantastic, maybe not so fantastic. And then you have a chance to, you know, establish a new path, a new habit, write even better code. So I thought I'd offer a couple of shocks to the system for, I think, the average PLSQL developer in my talk. So let's start by considering some of the things that we, in our little world of relational database technology in Oracle, say about SQL, the structured query language, the technology that really is the heart and soul of Oracle Corporation. It's big, it's amazing, it sells just about everything you can imagine, but it all comes back down to Oracle Database and SQL. So what do people say about SQL? Well, it's so easy to write SQL in PLSQL, and it really is. You can just write native SQL statements directly in PLSQL. You don't need ODBC, JDBC, this, that, the other. It's so easy to do. And what that really means is that we, as PLSQL developers, often take SQL for granted as we write our PLSQL code. How about no one else is ever going to need a SQL statement like this? In other words, a form of exceptionalism, which at least Americans seem to be rather in tune with. So as I'm writing my code, I'm always thinking to myself, this is new, this is different, this is so special. Nobody else is ever going to need something like that. Of course, I don't necessarily explicitly think that way, but at least in my actions, it pretty much exhibits that belief system because I don't make enough of an effort, and some of us make very little effort, to identify common elements of our application and make sure they're reused and not copied and pasted. So the exceptionalism, oh, nobody's ever going to need this 16-way join with this 25-line where clause, et cetera, et cetera. That exceptionalism is a rationalization, a reinforcement of our desire to just kind of like heads down, work on whatever we're working on at this moment, and not think about the bigger picture. How about Oracle will optimize it all for me automatically? Cost-based optimizer, this, that, and the other, auto-tuning. Wow, it doesn't matter how I write my SQL statements. Oracle's going to take care of me. Talk about drinking the Kool-Aid. Well, sure, Oracle does a lot for us, and it's going to do more and more and more with each release. It doesn't mean, however, that we don't have to take close care and pay close attention to how we write our SQL statements inside PLSQL and anywhere else. How about this insert statement's never going to raise a dupe file error. Now, what I mean by that, which is, by the way, another form of rationalization, what I mean by that is, as I'm writing a DML statement like an insert or an update or a delete, there are any number of errors that can occur. Sure, they can occur with select statements too, but not as many, not as likely. But certainly with DML, it's part of your business transaction usually. You need to think about, worry about, and handle potential errors. That's a pain in the neck. Exception handlers, what do I call, what do I pass to which table, and how do I log it? So why don't I just instead assume that things are going to be okie dokie? So I'm going to insert into this table. I don't have to worry about dupe val on index errors because there's a primary key in place, or there's this, or there's that. Or that we have a uniquely generated key, so why would I ever hit that error? These are all assumptions we make and rationalizations we make to avoid writing the right kind of code. Okay, so here's my shock therapy for you. Stop writing so much SQL. Big red line through SQL. What? Shocking! No, it can't be! Well, it isn't really, in some sense. So let me explain further what I mean by no SQL. Stop writing so much SQL. So we need to write SQL statements if we're going to run build applications against the Oracle database. No question about it. And even beyond that, the best place to put our SQL statements are within PLSQL blocks, within essentially a PLSQL API. So that's the message that we backend developers should have to Java developers and JavaScript developers and Python developers and whatever user interface front-end developers there are out there. Don't write SQL. Let us do it for you. Let's expose it through an API and so on. But that still leaves the question, what about us PLSQL developers? Come on, we know SQL, we're inside the database, can't we do whatever we want? Well, that's pretty much largely what PLSQL developers do, whatever they want. I've gone to training after training in which I would ask people, do you have any standards for writing PLSQL? And a lot of people raise their hands. Yes, we've got standards documents. Not that anybody ever reads them. Okay, how many of you have standards documents that have anything in there about when, where, and how to write SQL statements? Psh! All the hands come down. It's really quite amazing. Almost every time, all the hands come down. People just take SQL totally for granted. Us in particular, us PLSQL developers. And here's the thing. We should be very careful about how, when, and where we write SQL statements. And essentially, we should avoid repeating the same SQL statement more than once. But that's not the profile. The kind of situation we see in general, really, on a day-to-day basis, what I've heard from developers is that in our big back end, we've got our tables at the bottom. That's the baseline, the foundation of our application, of course. And then we're writing that application-level code. Now, sure, user interface people are writing application-level code, but we do too. And what I mean is not so much the low-level utilities like logging errors and parsing strings, but I'm implementing user requirements in the back end. And at that point, we're pretty much like Java developers or JavaScript developers. We just write SQL statements whenever we need to. It might be even a copy and paste of the same single row lookup, because why not? What's ever going to change about that? So we end up with a mess. We end up with basically a total loss of control of our application from the perspective of SQL, performance, maintenance, and so on. I know this is hard for PLSQL developers to get their head around. One of the approaches that I like to take in terms of a shock, going back to shock therapy, is this. I believe that every SQL statement you ever write, select, insert, update, delete, whatever, is a form of hard coding, and in fact, just about the worst form of hard coding in your application. What? SQL statements hard coding? That's crazy. And we partly have this very strong response to my statement, SQL statements are hard codings, because we all know how bad hard codings are and how professional developers don't put hard coding in their application, don't hard code literal values, you know, they might change at some point. But think about it, from a logical standpoint, there's really no difference between hard coded literal and a SQL statement. In both cases, what we're saying is at this moment in time, this value or this select statement represents some data that we need to use or pass back to the user. So the literal is the value itself that we need, like the maximum salary of employees in our company, or the minimum salary. The SQL statement identifies a data set that we need to use in our application. But clearly, more than with the literal, when you're writing a SQL statement, you're really saying just at this moment, this is the data set we need because everything changes. And certainly the underlying data model, the data, the relationships, they're always changing. So our SQL statements are going to change. But what we're saying is at that moment, that represents the current reality. So we write it there, we write it here, we write it there. How do you find all those duplications and make sure that you fix all of them? Same problem we have with hard-coded literals, but way, way worse, because they're much more critical elements of our application. And while you could theoretically, and sometimes rather safely, do a global search and replace of, say, 172435 with 176724, or whatever the case might be, you can't do that with SQL statements. So it seems to me rather important that we need to pay more attention to how, when, and where we write SQL statements. So what's a PLSQL developer supposed to do? You know what? What I have found is that what you're likely to do is ignore what I'm about to say, because it's just too hard to get our heads around something so different from what we've done for years, which is, I'm in PLSQL, SQL so easy, I'm just gonna do it whenever I want to. Very dangerous situation. So what should you do instead? And hopefully you won't ignore me. Build an API, build a data access layer around your SQL statement. So the same message that we give to our user interface friends, you write the pretty stuff. We'll take care of the hard work on the back end. We should be saying it to ourselves. We'll write, somebody in our organization, maybe we'll even generate it, will create a data access layer that has within it all the SQL statements that we need to use in our application. And then when I need to do an insert, I don't write insert into table. I call the insert procedure. When I need to do an update, when I need to get data, I call a function to retrieve the data, single row or an entire collection, cursor variable, whatever the appropriate return mechanism is. So building these APIs around the data in my application helps me approach a situation where I'm not repeating those SQL statements, but I'm calling existing code. It also lets me enhance my applications way more easily. Another really nice advantage of hiding the SQL behind a data access layer is that as Oracle comes out with new features, you're much more likely to be able to take advantage of them. In other words, you can more easily have a modern application rather than what looks more and more like a legacy dinosaur application that's just dying on the vine because it doesn't even use any of the new stuff. And a great example of this is the function result cache feature of Oracle 11g. Let's look at some code. Finally, so in Oracle 11g, Oracle added this great new feature called the function result cache. And I don't have time to go into all the details of it, but essentially, if you define a function to be a result cache function, then every time you or anybody else in the database calls that function, Oracle looks in its own little cache for that function and says, did somebody else already call this function with the same input values? If so, I'm not going to execute the function. I'm simply going to return the cached value. And if nobody has called it with that particular combination, essentially a unique index, then I will execute the function. I'll get the return value, I'll put all that in the cache, and then I'll send the value back to the user. So it's a great way to avoid executing the same code over and over again to get a data set that hasn't changed, a static data set. Really nice stuff. It can improve performance pretty dramatically in a number of different scenarios. My point here is that if you encapsulate now, if you hide away these areas of your code that are volatile, likely to change, and SQL sure is one of them, and you hide it around the API and call the API, not only do you get better productivity, you can upgrade more easily, but you'll be able to maintain a much more current version of your code base with Oracle features than you otherwise would. If you disperse your logic all over the place, especially your SQL statements, your application will calcify. You won't be able to stay current. It'll just look older and older. It'll work worse and worse. It'll be harder and harder to maintain. So, that is my shock therapy for you to consider. Stop writing so much SQL. Still, you got to write it. Still, you should write it. If you're a PLSQL developer, it should be in the back end. But build that layer of code around your SQL statements, around your data. And not only through a PLSQL API, another example of a great API around SQL are views. In general, never select against tables. Always select against views. This is particularly true when you're building reports, let's say in Application Express. You're going to write a select statement. You're not going to go through a PLSQL API, most likely. Select from a view. That way, if you need to change things around and make it more complex, the impact on the application level code will be minimized. So I hope that's given you a really nice example of what's involved in terms of taking a different approach to doing things. So we all develop habits and they can get really, really deep, especially because we're always under so much pressure to produce now. Never have enough time to do it right and follow all the best practices. So I know that this is always a struggle. And particularly around SQL, it can be a struggle to change the way you do it. But hopefully, if you can step back a little bit and say, wow, you know, I think Stephen might actually be right. Maybe SQL statements, every one of those selects, are just as bad a form of hard coding as a hard-coded literal. If you can really see that logically, that can help you start to change your view on SQL generally and encourage you to build those APIs. And believe me, you will feel so much better. Your users will have a much better experience with the application, and you'll be building code in a much more modern way, much more flexible way. And you'll say, Stephen, thanks for that therapy session. Thanks for that shock therapy. That was just what I needed. So hopefully you will say that to me someday. In the meantime, enjoy my other videos on coding therapy, and happy PLSQL coding.